Good afternoon, everyone. Today I am going to talk about our signal reconstruction. We in our group are working on a lot of different reconstruction problems, and over the time we came up with a set of tools which we are using all the time, and we are starting to abstract them in a way that one has basically a toolkit, and if you have a reconstruction problem, you can take this toolkit and plug take all the individual parts of it, plug them together to get a very specific reconstruction algorithm, which can be used to build extract the most of the data as possible. So the most information about the data you are having. I will start with one example. Here you see the ALMA telescope. It's a radio telescope in Chile, and this is not only one instrument, but actually it is a radio interferometer as well as a single dish telescope. So it can measure the interferometric signal from the sky as well as single dish information, where you just point at one point into the sky and measure the flux. Those are two completely different kinds of information, but of the same part of the sky. And one question one could ask is how to combine these different measurements into one unified reconstruction, because the interferometer is very good at picking up small scales, whereas the single dish is very good at picking up large scales. So here you basically see what the two different kinds of instruments see. The single dish looks at some point into the sky, measures something, and what you see here is basically back projected on where this data would have come from, whereas for the interferometer, you measure one individual frequency, so this is one baseline, and one individual frequency of the Fourier transformed sky brightness. So this is really completely different kind of information of the same part of the sky. And we do not only have one pointing of the single dish, but we have many of them, and as well as we have many baselines for the interferometer. So we just add them up, and basically we get this kind of information from the different instruments. And now the task, what we want to do is, we want to combine these different things into one reconstruction, because the single dish is very smeared out and you don't have any small scale structures, where it's the other way around for the interferometer. So how do we do this? Well, as I said, they are looking at the same thing into the sky, and they provide us with different data from exactly that place. So what connects them is the physical reality, which we're both looking at. So, and how do we combine this data? Well, we ask Bayes how to do this. So this is just typical Bayes theorem. We want to learn about the sky brightness given the data, and we get this by looking at the likelihood given a signal configuration. Given a signal configuration, how likely is the data we observed by the instrument or the measurement process, and combine this with prior knowledge on our signal itself, and then we have to normalize again. But probabilities are not that convenient to work with. Instead, we will work with information. Information is just the negative logarithm of the probability distribution, and they have some advantages to work with. So we now don't have only one data set, but we have two. So what happens is we just have to multiply the individual likelihoods together, and then we can infer what the individual data sets tell us about the reality on the sky, given the prior knowledge. So in terms of information, this looks like this. There we just have to add the individual terms. So we have this H0, which is a constant, which does not depend on the signal. And then we have the information from the one instrument, the information from the other instrument, plus the prior information. So we just have to add them up. And this describes the problem. And now this is not the only way how we can add information. We can also think about more complex prior models, which leads to a more complex structure within all the priors, which then depend on other parameters and so on. But overall, in the information, this just leads to more terms. And in there, we build up some kind of hierarchy, but this object describes the problem fully. And this does not yet tell us how to solve the problem, but this is a formal mathematical description on what we want to do, or what the problem is defined. So let us talk about the sky, because this is a very important object. And what does it look like? Well, for example, it can be some one-dimensional quantity. It can be a two-dimensional quantity. It can be three-dimensional if we have some tomography problem. It can have spectral dimensions. It can have temporal dimensions. And it can also live on some other kind of topology, for example, on the sphere. And this now is basically the stage where we put our physical reality onto. And in this reality, we have to model the kinds of components or what we expect to see in the real world. And what we see there, for example, are unknown sources. A lot of parts of the sky, we know what to expect, maybe with some uncertainty, but we can then put in there. Other components are maybe some diffuse emission, as we have seen before, so large extended structures. Of course, point sources are everywhere, and maybe emission lines, if we have spectral dimensions, time variable sources, if we have temporal dimensions, and so on. So, and one can really think about what to expect, and one has to model this in terms of some prior distributions. Okay, for our radio reconstruction, we might want to use something like this. So we have a two-dimensional image. We expect point sources and diffuse emission. So that's what you typically see in radio images. And for the diffuse emission, one might not know the correlation structure of the diffuser. So how far does the correlation length of the components go? So this might also be part of the problem we want to solve. And now onto this sky, sky model, we plug our two instruments. Both instruments look at the sky, and this now corresponds to one of these information terms. So every box in there basically corresponds to one additional term in the description of our problem. And now this has the structure. We can see the dependency in there. And now we can, for example, solve it by using some maximum posterior. So we minimize the amount of information of some parameter configurations, and we get maybe some results. But typically, this is not enough, especially if we approximate it like this. We ignore all kinds of posterior uncertainties. If we use some other probability distribution to approximate it with, by some variational approach, for example, one can capture, in addition, the uncertainty between all the different quantities. And they are propagated to some extent correctly. So let's look on how this looks like if we do a variational reconstruction of the data I've shown before. Assume this is the truth. So we have two point sources. Here's one, and here's one. We have some diffuse background. Now, how does it look like if we only use the single dish information? It looks like this. Of course, all the point sources are gone. You don't really see small-scale structures. If we take only the interferometric data, the larger scales are completely off, but we recover the small scales. And now let's combine it. Looks like this. So the small scales, as well as the large scales, are somehow better. So again, the truth looks like this. So the combination definitely gives better results than the individual ones. So now, what is UBIC? UBIC is basically the toolkit on how to plug together such algorithms. It consists of three different parts. On the one side is the numerical reality. We have a Python package for that, where you can plug together such an algorithm. On the other side, how to solve such a problem. This is the inference part. And then some libraries where you have models in there which you can plug together. So what is Nifty? Nifty is a Python library which defines all the interface that nothing can go wrong. It supports auto-differentiation. It supports MPI parallelization. It implements its own minimizers and a lot more. On the inference part, I've talked about the variational inference or maximum posterior. So those are the choices, but maybe also something more complex, such as a Hamiltonian Monte Carlo or whatever one wants. On the model side, we talked about the sky, which can be this complex thing. And the other important thing is our instruments, which basically describe how the data is generated from some observation. Basically, if you want to have a reconstruction for your instrument, you have to somehow represent your instrument in this language, but then you can just plug it in and use the entire framework to solve your problems. Okay, and this is something, so the top part is something which is increasing constantly, so we are adding new instruments, we are adding new sky models and so on. Let's briefly go back to this one. So how could one expand something like this? Interferometers need calibration. They have internal states which are a priori not known and they change with time, for example, the phase calibration. In order to do this, one typically also looks at some known source in addition to the science target to fix the phases of the instrument, so to sharpen it up, basically. And you have to constantly recalibrate it, and you have to switch between the science target and the calibrator source, and later on you have to apply the calibration and then reconstruct it. If you make the calibration also part of this problem, what happens is that we do not only use the calibrator source to fix the calibration of the phases, but we can also use the science target. There might also be some point sources in there which are already quite good, which we already have a quite good reconstruction. But the entire time we are not looking at the calibrator source, we assume the calibration either to be constant or interpolating between the times we look at it. And this way one could improve on that, because one could use more information on that. So what else can one do? So what you see here is not only one algorithm, but actually a number of. So if we look only at this part, this is basically describes the problem of the calibration of an interferometer. So you could also just solve this problem and get the classical way on how to calibrate such an instrument. If you ignore this interferometer part, then you have the single dish reconstruction algorithm, as well as only this. There you have only the interferometer reconstruction. But what you can also do is you can cut away here, and given you have some sky and you want to know what are the point sources, what is the diffuse emission, you can just use this description, solve the problem, and you have a separation algorithm for background and diffuse emission and point sources. So really one has to plug together a lot of different things, and each individual permutation is basically its own description of a problem which can be solved independently if one wants to. So what do we want to do in the future? Well, we need more space. One can think about more calibration of interferometers or other instruments. One can include temporal correlations and the phase shifts. Well, actually, this is something which is already working. Then one can add additional instruments. One can add their calibrations to that. And what's especially interesting is, because you have all these instruments which already constrain the sky, it gets better and better to calibrate it on the actual target itself. So this is still somewhat in the future, but that's definitely somewhere we want to go. And one can also, for example, use this to constrain the, or to also recover the background of some X-ray telescope, for example, because it separates in the time direction. So you have some static sky, more or less static, and on the other side you have something which changes with time, and the algorithm should be able to pick this up. So, and of course one can think about a lot more things one could add. And the good thing is it is fully modular, so if one adds one block to it, basically everyone else could also use it in its own algorithm. And yeah, well, basically it is fully configurable to whatever you want it to do. So thank you.